Good morning, everybody. Boy, slim pickings this morning, ain't it? Yeah. Shannon got a green reunion today, so that most of y'all know that's why Wendell and them ain't here and she ain't here. And I guess that's about it. Four. All right, thanks, baby. But anyway, we'll go on and get started. That way they won't start eating without me and Jana. But anyway, if y'all stand, we'll get started in singing this morning. I know I ain't as pretty as Darlene. I ain't nothing to look at, and I can't sing as good as her, but at least I'm entertaining. That's right. Well, thank you, thank you. You know you in church, amen. Be careful. Time coming here on Sunday and Wednesday. I look forward to it. It's good to have some loving, beautiful people like y'all to be worshiping with, too. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we thank you for your mercy. Father, just thank you that you wake us up every day with new grace and new mercy. Father, thank you that your mercy calls us out through your saving grace, Father. And thank you that your scripture says that we are being saved. Because if we were saved, we'd be glorified, Father, and we look forward to that day. We thank you for the encouragement that's provided in the Word, Father, that we have the day that comes that we will be and doing nothing but just bask in your glory, Father, that just Your glory will be the light that lights up the entire, our new world, Father, the new heaven and the new earth, Father. When we so forward look to that, Father, we just thank you for the encouragement it provides, and thank you for your faithfulness, most importantly, Father, that you get us to the point we are. It's through the power of your Holy Spirit, Father, that we're able to persevere and endure each and every day, Father. And we just pray that you continue to create that desire and ability in us to persevere each day, Father, so that one day we will be in the presence and glory of you and your Son, Father, and for all you do for us. And we just pray that as we sing and worship this morning, Father, and as we hear your word this morning, that we would be encouraged, but we would also glorify you in the name of Jesus. We ask these things in the precious name of your Son. Amen.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder,
never forgotten, never forsaken, never abandoned.
key. The Lord telling me to get off my lazy can and stand up. But, oh, good grief. Jeremy, go sit there. There it went. That got it messed up. Sorry. I'll put that over there. 11 o'clock morning worship. And 6 o'clock Bible study on Facebook Live with Brother Mike. And then Wednesday night we got prayer meeting at 7 o'clock and Bible study. Wednesday, May the 15th, we got a deacons meeting at 6:45 and a 7 o'clock business meeting. And Sunday, May the 26th, a fellowship lunch following the morning service. Oh, okay. Oh, okay. Well, we might have to play that by ear. So, well, we done got the birthdays behind us this month. Miss Kathy, Dana, and Miss Lyle. And then Mr. Butler and Miss Sanders celebrated their anniversary this month. Is that it, brother? Well, I guess Miss Kathy ain't here this morning, so I'm about the oldest young one here, I reckon. Well, besides Jenna, we'll just move on past that and go to our offertory hymn. If y'all will stand up. These four verses, brother, for this morning. Thank you for this day, Father. Just thank you for this opportunity to be in your house and worship this morning, Father. And just thank you again for your faithfulness, Father, your relentlessness to come after your people, Father. Just thank you that you keep us engaged in your word, keep us in the desire and the willingness and the ability, Father, to follow you and your teachings. Father, at this time we just ask that you would bless these tithes and offerings, Father, as we give back what you have so richly given to us, Father, just that you would take them and use them for the furtherance of your kingdom, Father, to spread the good news of the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus. And Father, I just pray that you be with Brother Mike as he brings the word this morning. Father, just allow your Holy Spirit to flow through him, Father, that he would bring the message that we all need to hear this morning, Father, and just pray that you would open our hearts and minds and we would be receptive to your truth and we would be able to apply it to our everyday lives and go out and use it and point people to Jesus, Father. These things I ask in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Hopefully the YouVersion link will work this morning. I don't know if y'all tried it yet. Because Scripture's not going to be up there, so y'all going to have to follow along in your Bibles or your apps or whatever you use to read God's Word. But hopefully it's working. Remember, my theme for this year is God's wisdom. John 7:37. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink." I'll ask you a question. What happens when things go without water for a long period of time? Okay, that's extreme, but... But before they get to that part, okay, think about your plants and your crops, right? They get dry, right? They start to become dry and likely will result in a drought occurring. You know, there's many a farmer around here that's probably suffered a drought at some point in their farming career. But by definition, a drought can be defined as a period of dryness, especially when prolonged, specifically one that causes extensive damage to crops or prevents their successful growth. So I want to change that up a little bit, and I'm going to do a little tweak and a modification on that definition. A period of dryness, especially when prolonged, specifically one that causes extensive damage to our spiritual health or prevents our successful spiritual growth. Ask yourself this question. Are you in a season of spiritual dryness? You got to be honest with yourself. If you answered yes, then there's a good chance you're not alone. Even the most passionate, on fire, strong in their faith believers walk through days, weeks, and even months of feeling empty inside. You can feel distant from God and spiritually sluggish. In churches, folks who once filled the pews now prefer to stay home on Sunday. Folks don't think church is important anymore. They don't think they need to come sit and have the time of fellowship and get recharged through God's word, through worship, and through the message. You know, that's between them and God. But when folks are spiritually dry or going through a spiritual drought, it usually means they feel distant from God or might be struggling with their spiritual growth. They don't see or feel like God is working in their lives. The burdens of everyday life press in, and they begin to feel discouraged. They search for God in a dry and parched land where there is no water. In Psalm 63:1, "You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water." Shouldn't we all be earnestly seeking God? Shouldn't we have that thirst for God? Shouldn't we desire to be with God, to have that relationship? I want you to give yourself a checkup and ask yourself if you've got any of these symptoms. Do you feel bored when reading the Bible? Or do you even read the Bible at all? Disinterested in prayer. Weariness with church attendance. A sense of purposelessness. A lack of joy. And a gradual pulling away from the Lord because he seems too distant to understand. If you've got any of these symptoms, spiritual dryness is probably upon you. And if you don't change, it's going to become a spiritual drought. The spiritual dryness might be common, but if we take it too lightly, it can lead to the unraveling of our relationship with God and others, and likely will lead to a full-blown spiritual drought. And oftentimes, when folks get in that drought, they turn completely away from God. They shut him out. They walk away. And there can be several reasons for spiritual dryness, so I'm going to take a look at just a few of them. Who wants to take a shot at the very first one? If you paid attention, I've kind of hit on this the last 3 weeks. Sometimes spiritual dryness is due to our personal sin. Sin can cause us to feel separated from God because we are attempting to live for ourselves instead of living for God. Unconfessed sin can cause us to lose the joy associated with our salvation. In Psalm 51:12, "Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me." You see, in a time of dryness, we need to take God at his word. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. And that comes from James 4:8. "Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded." Though we may make an enemy out of God by turning our back on him, like hard-headed folks, we need his grace. We need his mercy. And fortunately for us, God loves his children. And he's able and ready to pour out his grace and mercy upon us. And there's one thing, though. We must first draw near to him. We've got to seek him. He's not going to force his love. He's not going to force us to change our ways. He's not going to force us to accept him. He's not going to force us to come to this altar and ask for forgiveness of our sins and repent. He's not going to do it. That choice is ours and ours alone. When someone says they just don't really feel close to God anymore, or they are not where they should be spiritually, they're to blame. When we feel like that, ourselves, we're to blame. Nobody but us. Nobody can make us open God's Word. Nobody can make us pray. Nobody can make us come to church. Nobody can make us have that relationship. That's something that we should desire to do, because we know the outcome if we don't. God is a God of grace and mercy, ready to pour it out upon us. Yet we refuse to draw near to Him. Some think they're drawing near, but unless they obey and keep themselves from sin, they're just having some spiritual experience or doing some religious exercise. And often that's because they want to play the part, but they don't want to put in the work. I'm going to come to church. I'm going to be seen in church. But during the week, I'm going to do what I want to do. I'm not going to have that relationship. I'm going to continue to sin. I'm going to continue to disobey God. But I'm going to be there on Sunday because I want to look like I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. They're going through the exercise. They're going through the motions. God wants a heart that by faith obeys Him. And we need to repent and confess our sin that we're currently in. We all sin. We all fall short of God's glory because we are sinners. But God is a loving God, a merciful God, a God full of grace. So He allows us to confess that sin, to ask for forgiveness, and to repent. Being double-minded, and there's a lot of this in society today, trying to enjoy the pleasures of the world, even though we are children of God. Attempts to do so will dry us up spiritually. You can't have it both ways. Either you're going to be a child of God and be obedient to your Father in heaven, or you're going to be a child of the devil and the pleasures of the world. You can't do both. I mean, you can, but that's not what we're supposed to be doing. And it's ultimately going to end to disastrous consequences. Like y'all said earlier, when something dries up, eventually it's going to die. And if you continue to turn from God and you continue to stay in that period of dryness, you're going to dry up. And it could ultimately lead to death. They pray, but they doubt. God calls them to change so that He can draw near to them. They must make the first move. We can remedy the season of dryness by confessing our sin to God before it becomes a spiritual drought. In 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. When we feel the conviction of sin, and if you are a child of God, you truly do have salvation and you do have a relationship with God. When you sin, you should feel that conviction. You should feel the Holy Spirit working inside of you going, hey, this ain't right. You need to make it right. If you don't feel that, you need to examine your spiritual walk, your spiritual life, and your spiritual health because it's lacking somewhere. If you continue to sin and don't feel anything wrong about it, there's a problem. When we feel the conviction of sin, we should ask God for forgiveness and those that we have wronged. Because often our sin has caused hurt to somebody else, or we have wronged somebody else. Standing before God, we are forgiven. Yet conditionally, we can dirty ourselves in sin. When we do this, we need to own up to our wrongs and ask for forgiveness of them and turn away from those sins and temptations. Is it easy? Absolutely not, because if it was, everybody would be on board. You wouldn't have so many people fighting against God and what the truth of His Word tells us. Some people feel spiritually dry because of physical, mental, or emotional pain. When we are sick, it is often more difficult to focus on God or spiritual things. And when we go through difficult times, that's when we often turn away from God because we get angry that He's not answering our prayers. But that's the time that we really should be turning to Him and seeking Him, because we know God answers prayers. But it's His timing, His way, not ours. He knows what's best for us. But God does answer our prayers. It may not be today. It may not be tomorrow. It may not be in 10 years. Or it may never be answered in the way that we had hoped it was. But God is in control. God sometimes allows a person to reach a low point before intervening in a powerful way. The time before that intervention can feel spiritually dry. God can tear us all the way down to the ground to build us right back up. Three other ways that cause us to become spiritually dry are the easiest to overcome. When the time we spend reading God's Word lacks, our time spent in prayer to the Father becomes diminished, and our fellowship with other believers takes a back seat, then our spiritual health begins to dry up. And the longer we fail to open God's Word, pray, and seek the fellowship of believers, and the drier we become, and the closer we become to a spiritual drought. If this is you, or you know somebody who's going through a dry spell or even a drought, there's good news. God offers us the solutions to our spiritual dryness, even our spiritual drought. We've already heard God's command to draw near to Him with the promise that He will draw near to us. But draw near to Him, that means putting down the cell phones, turning off the TVs, getting in a quiet place, and spending some time with Him. Because how are you ever going to expect to hear Him if you don't slow down long enough and get quiet and still to listen? We've got to open up these books that often collect dust on people's bookshelf or their nightstands or wherever else they may put it. But if your Bible's dusty, then you ain't reading God's Word. Now, if you're on the app, you know, especially the Bible app, it tracks how many days you've been in it. If you've got a dry spell in there where you ain't been in it, and if you might need to re-examine it and wipe that screen off and clear that dust off so you can see it. There's some accountability there. But we got to spend time in God's Word. We've got to seek God through His Word. And in God's Word, we see the faithfulness, the mercy, the grace, and the love of God. All that has been written as Holy Scripture is for our learning, our encouragement, and hope, so that we persevere and bear abundant fruit. We are sanctified by the Word of God, for it is the truth, the only truth. In John 17:17, sanctify them by the truth. Your Word is truth. In Romans 15:4, for everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the Scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. Because without hope, we have nothing. And when we lose hope, we often give up. This verse affirms the inspiration and authority of the Scriptures. All that had been written and given by God was to be taken as that which was the truth of God for the purpose of instructing us. We've got to read the Scripture and learn what God wants and does not want. Then we'll be able to persevere in faith as we obey Him. Knowing who He is, how He works, and what He wants from us. There's also great encouragement to be found in the Scripture, because we can see how God has been faithful to keep His promises. We see the mercy of God, the power of God, and the unfailing love of God. Story after story after story. And then we got prayer. Where are you at in your prayer life? In Philippians 4:6-7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. every situation by prayer. Trusting in Christ and praying about our needs and realizing that God can do anything, and we need to trust Him, commit to Him as we obey Him, give thanks to Him, and give our requests to Him in prayer. God already knows our needs, but we can be faithful, and by faith remove the burden upon ourselves of stress and worry by giving it to Him as we petition Him in prayer. But what do? We say, okay, God, I'm going to give it to You. I'm going to let You have it. And then what happens? Whoop, we pick it right back up because we think we can do a better job. Guilty. Especially us men folk. We think we can handle it no matter what it is. But until God puts you on your knees, brings you to tears, and lets you know, hey, you can't do this. Let Me take that burden. That's why I am here. And that's what we've got to do. Give it to Him in prayer. We've seen prayer work. We've seen it right here in our church. We've seen it in our families and our community. We know there's power in prayer. We just got to do it. We've got to take that time to read God's Word and to pray. Got to. And when we trust God, God's peace goes beyond worth and is so valuable and precious. God gives us peace, which for us is better than total understanding. Because the peace that comes from God is like no other. No matter what you're going through, when you have God's peace in your heart, you can endure. Although you may not understand what's going on and why things are not happening the way you want them to happen, you still have that peace. And when we keep our minds fixed upon Christ and His Word in faith, we can have that peace. In Jeremiah 29:13, "You will seek Me and find Me when you seek Me with all your heart." With all your heart, not part of it, all of it. Prayer is our ultimate indication of our trust in our Heavenly Father. Only when we pray do we surrender our problems completely to God and then ask for His divine intervention. God, I give it to You. I give it all to You. I surrender. And that's what we have to do. But many fail to make prayer a daily routine. They want to pray when it's convenient. They want to pray when they want something. Folks, prayer is not an option. It's required. In 1 Timothy 2:1, "I urge then first of all that petitions, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people." Prayer from a righteous heart in belief and according to the will of God. Even if the society around us is hostile toward Christ and us, we can have the peace of God and live in a godly way, thereby being tranquil of soul. And if we carry all the burdens on our shoulders, we will get weighed down. But if we let Christ carry our burdens as we offer petitions to Him with thanksgiving, we can have peace. Have you ever been talking to somebody? And you can tell by the expressions on their face that they're burdened, that they're heavy laden. And then when they finally decide to let it go and to give it to God and surrender it all, that burden's lifted and the color comes back into their face. The life comes back into them. You see that facial expression change. You haven't ever witnessed it. It's very powerful. Charles Spurgeon said it like this: "To seek aid in time of distress from a supernatural being is an instinct of human nature. I believe in the truthfulness of this instinct, and that man prays because there's something in prayer. When he inclines men to pray, it is because prayer has a corresponding blessing connected with it." Dr. E. Stanley Jones had this to say. In prayer, you align yourselves to the purpose and power of God, and He is able to do things through you that He couldn't do otherwise. For this is an open universe where some things are left open, contingent upon our doing them. If we do not do them, they will never be done. For God has left certain things open to prayer, things which will never be done except as we pray. And the last way I want to mention to overcome spiritual dryness is fellowship with other believers. One of the strengths of the early church was that they spent time with one another. In Acts 2, 46 and 47, every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. God's purpose for His people is fellowship, encouragement, and true relationships. In simple terms, Christian fellowship, then, is the mutual beneficial relationship between Christians who can't have the identical relationship with those outside of their faith. It's a different kind of fellowship, or at least it should be. Christ followers experience true fellowship, oneness with one another, with Christ and with the Father. Just as the Father is in Jesus, so is Jesus in us. And we have unity with one another because of the uniqueness of that relationship. In 1 John 1:3, we proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. This relationship must be the basis of Christian fellowship. Believers can have friendships and relationship with unbelievers, as Jesus did. He didn't always associate with believers. He had dinner with the sinners. But He had a goal and a mission behind it. True Christian fellowship can only occur within the body of Christ. We're united to one another by common beliefs, purposes, and goals. The importance of true Christian fellowship is that it reinforces these things in our mind and helps us to focus on Christ and His desires and goals for us. As iron sharpens iron in true Christian fellowship, Christ followers sharpen one another's faith and stir one another to exercise their faith in love and good works, all to God's glory. Jesus promised, "Whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spirit of water dwelling up to eternal life." Living water from our Lord is a sure cure for spiritual dryness and drought. In John 4:14, "But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water dwelling up to eternal life." Jesus Christ is the only satisfactory source to quench our dry and thirsty souls. Faith is the key to partaking of the fountain of the water of life. The soul-quenching fountain of living water flows from Jesus Christ to us through the indwelling Holy Spirit. Jesus offers unlimited refills. Anyone who believes in Christ, receives His salvation, and obeys Him will never thirst again because they drink from an unlimited supply of pure and living water. And if you're in a season of spiritual dryness or even a spiritual drought, then flood your mind and heart with God's Word. Replenish your soul with prayer and solitude with the Lord, and be saturated with fellowship with other Christ followers. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank You for this day. Thank You for the message, Lord, You laid upon my heart. Lord, oftentimes we do go through a period of dryness, and often it leads to a period of drought. Lord, I just ask that You guide and lead us, Father. That You fill us with that living water. That You strengthen us, Father. that you remind us each and every day to open your word, to read it, to have a time of solitude and prayer, and to seek fellowship with other believers, to come to church, to be fed, to be recharged, to be obedient, to serve you faithfully and to do as you have called us to do, Father. Lord, fill us with your wisdom. Fill us with the strength and the truth of your word, Father. Lord, thank you so much for all that you do for us, the answered prayers, the blessings, those that we have already seen fulfilled, those which are yet to come, but we know are coming. Father, I come to you now with a request for healing, for you are the great physician, and we know all healing is through you and by you, Father. And as such, Lord, I ask that if it's your will, you lay your hands upon these individuals, each and every one of them, Father, here in our church, our own families, and our community, Lord. You know their healing needs. Lord, I ask that you heal and restore them. Take away any pain that they may have. Give them hope, strength, peace, encouragement. Let your presence be felt upon them. Let your touch be felt. Lord, for those that are struggling, those that are going through a difficult time right now, those that have unspoken prayers, Lord, I ask if it's your will, you lift them up, guide them, bless them, provide for them, strengthen them, Father. Give them hope. And Lord, for those that may be in a drought, those that have turned away, those that may not know you, those that may be in a place of darkness, Father. Lord, that you would bless them with the light that comes from your word. Bless them with a church. Bless them with somebody that will love them and share the truth and the good news of the gospels, Father. Let them seek you that their lives may be changed and their souls saved. Lord, again, I ask for your blessings upon our church. Lord, we're thankful for all that you've done. We ask for those continued blessings, Father. Let us do our part to further your kingdom and to serve you faithfully. Lord, we love you and we thank you. And it's with all the honor and glory that you so deserve. Amen.
Said, stand to your feet. We'll start with a prayer. If you have a need, let it be heard, saints, let it be known. We're all a family, you're not alone. And that's when he saw her at the back of the church, her silence and sadness. Shepherd knew just what to say. I need to know before we pray. An unspoken request. Does anybody have one here tonight? Did you come with a burden you can't share? A need in your life?
Spoken request.